If I could describe the Resident Evil CG movies in a few words or a few terms, it would be frantic, over the top, and definitely filled to the brim with formula fiction. The classic proverb of "if it ain't broke, don't fix it" applies after seeing all three Resident Evil CGI movies in complete order from Degeneration to Damnation and finally culminating to the end with the newly released Resident Evil Vendetta. I was going to make a formal by the numbers review expressing some of my disappointment for Resident Evil Vendetta because while the formula fiction has been present within all three movies, it's honestly getting a little stale at this rate. Creativity is starting to dry up, and usually as a company that could signal the beginning of the end if your recent movie just wasn't up to snuff critically and financially. So what happens when formula fiction, a term used to describe reused plot elements from a narrative, is utilized and it starts to become widely predictable in your franchise? Well, that's when a substantial change is in order before you progress to the next entry. Here's my opinion piece on the pros and cons of the Resident Evil CG movies. Before we begin, we need to go back to where this party started with Resident Evil Degeneration. Resident Evil Degeneration was released in 2008, a year before the release of Resident Evil 5 in 2009. This was Capcom's first big attempt trying to bring this biopunk horror series as a big major motion picture as they collaborated with Sony Pictures and Digital Frontier. It's interesting to note that Digital Frontier is a big company that handles the production of large-scale CGI movies and motion capture. A lot of their works include other popular titles like Tekken 6 and 7 for the cutscenes, Vanquish, Metal Gear Rising, and Tekken Blood Vengeance. While Degeneration managed to get some mixed reception mostly due to the stagnant pacing and dialed-in acting, Resident Evil Degeneration managed to kick up at least $1.6 million on return with home video. It inspired an arguably better sequel with Resident Evil Damnation and landed back to mixed reception status yet again for me personally when it comes to Resident Evil Vendetta. I think that while Damnation has a little bit of issues, it tries to mainly avoid what the first film struggled with, and that's the long, boring, overblown sessions of talking where nothing noteworthy occurs. I would say Resident Evil Vendetta is a very special case because supposedly this movie rebooted the format and is handed over to Marza Animation Planet, a Sega studio, instead of Digital Frontier, which is kind of weird. But basically, Marza Animation Planet oversaw this project. Despite having some pretty awesome action scenes, Vendetta still retreads on a lot of problems that the first film had, while adding in some convoluted plot elements and some weird character motivations that throws all logical sense right back out the window. Now we have a bigger situation to think about. What is going to be the future of these CG movies? Surely they are better than the live-action Resident Evil movies by far, but will Capcom continue their partnership with Marza since this new rebooted style, this new testament for Resident Evil Vendetta, really hasn't gone so well? I'd like to point out that Kobayashi, the producer and overseer of these films, did say that he would love to work on a new CGI premise like Devil May Cry or Dino Crisis, so if it was up to me, I would say that the CGI Resident Evil movies need to take a bit of a nap as we get more variety on the table. Kinda like Capcom should do with their games, but that's besides the point. Anyway, while we backtrack on things that they could fix, here's some things that I wrote up that could be taken into advisement considering the fact that we don't want the CGI movies to stay in that same stagnant formula. So here's some things that could be taken as pros and cons, also keeping what works and what doesn't. Let's begin. The pros. Let's keep the basic outbreak formula here. If there's one thing that I thought about deeply, I cannot imagine Resident Evil in any format without some form of a virus or outbreak causing chaos to the protagonist trying to escape the situation. This all started with a viral outbreak back in the Spencer Mansion all those years ago, so that basic concept should go mostly untouched. Number two, the intense, beautiful action scenes should stay. Let's be honest. All three of these movies have some pretty brilliant set pieces within. Even if the third movie tends to go a little bit overboard, a little bit too far into the deep end as we see Leon execute a zombie dog with a gunshot, a signpost, then finally he ends it with a goddamn grenade being tossed into incoming traffic. Just sit there and process how ridiculous this sounds. It's going to be spoilers. It's going to be spoilers, by the way, for these movies. So, despite some of these action scenes being utterly stupid, it's what keeps people amused. So, I don't think that they should be entirely taken away. I think these scenes are what happens when they try to put a lot of effort into these big set pieces, for better or for worse. While a lot of old school Resident Evil fans are mostly tired of the occasional action set piece within this universe because they might be tired of action in Resident Evil in general, I just can't imagine a horror thriller film without some form of bloodshed being brought into the equation. The final positive I have to say is that the more connections to the games, the better. Honestly, this is a huge plus for me as a Resident Evil fan, and let me explain why in blunt detail. This is a huge reason why I did not like most of the new characters in the live-action Resident Evil films, because, quite frankly, I didn't know who they were. I was stuck wondering, scratching my head, who the hell is Alice? Who is Rain? Who is Red Queen? Who is Spence Parks? Now, the movie, the live action movies in particular for Resident Evil, they tried to do their best job establishing what's happening with the new characters. And don't get me wrong, I don't hate new additions and new characters to a franchise. However, if I feel as though that character is pretty much worthless, or they're filling up the spotlight way too much, or they turn into a Mary Sue, which is exactly what Alice turned into, then I'm not gonna like that character as a good representation of a good story. I just don't feel that same way. I don't feel that same connection to the live action franchise as much as I do with the CG movies. So I give them their credit there. It really is amazing to see these characters or to see references come back here or there. The CGI movies just give people what they want up front with the main characters they resonate with from the games, like Chris, like Leon, like Ada, like Rebecca coming in. Those little nods are pretty much connective tissue to other Resident Evil games. Other stuff is also included, like Los Illuminados or the G-Virus making some form of a return for the first movie. It's something that is easily recognizable. However, it is sadly a flaw for some of the characters in terms of moving forward to the cons, but I'll discuss those in a bit. Alright, now we are going to get into the cons of what I think should change for the Resident Evil CGI movies. Remember, this is all opinion, not fact, so yeah, just remember that. First and foremost, I think that Leon S. Kennedy needs to take a break from main character status for the CG movies. Now, let me explain. I know Leon is the face. He is one of the most popular Resident Evil characters. He's up there as the face of Resident Evil alongside Jill, Chris, and Wesker. However, I think that Leon does not need to be the protagonist of the next entry unless they do something ambitious with his character in terms of a massive time skip. Let me explain. From Resident Evil 6 onwards to Vendetta, it seems like Chris and Leon are very, very weary. They're just tired. they're old. They're tired of constantly fighting BOWs on a daily basis. Personally, I would like to see Chris and Leon in one more entry where they are significantly older, still trying to fight BOWs, but way past their prime. I mean, wouldn't that be rather interesting? Metal Gear Solid 4 did this with an age Solid Snake, so why not do this premise for Resident Evil? I think that maybe this should be the case, and they should make a fitting in for the series eventually, but until that happens, Leon should be pretty much on the back burner. He's been in 3 films and plenty of entries. Let that man take a rest. I know he has star power, but let someone else take the main character mantle in regards to these movies. I remember when the original rumors happened with Resident Evil Vendetta, I think. The original rumor said that it was going to be probably Billy Cohen and Rebecca Chambers together in a movie, which would have been interesting considering the fact that they do have a significant history, as well as Chris having a history with Rebecca. So I think that would have been more interesting instead of having just Leon, Chris, and Rebecca all bundled into one movie, because I mean, it's time to give Leon that backseat. He really didn't do anything super significant story-wise for Vendetta except taking down the monster. So yeah, I think it's about time to put him into retirement for a while. Same with Chris. Number 2 as a con is horror being largely overlooked as a theme. There's one big issue I have with the Marza animation project, and that was Resident Evil Vendetta was supposed to be a return to form for injecting some horror into the mix for the CG movies. However, that didn't come to fruition. It seems as though there was slight glimmers of hope, because while most of the Marza animation planet workers mostly worked on anime focused projects, there was one person in particular that could have really homed in on this aspect, and his name was Takashi Shimizu. He is the executive producer of Resident Evil Vendetta, and I suppose his credentials were very underutilized here, because outside of the mansion sequence, this movie is really not going on the scare factor anymore. So I still wonder what the movie would have been like if they actually went in a horror direction for Resident Evil Vendetta, because Mr. Shimizu here, he has a rap sheet that worked on the Ju-on series, The Grudge, stuff like that. So it seems like that was majorly underutilized. There is one creature in Resident Evil Vendetta that mirrors pretty much how one of the Ju-on monsters look with the long black hair, but that's about it. Nothing else is scary about that movie. And before people get on me about saying that, how could this movie be scary when Chris and Leon are super agents? I'm not sure if people saw Biohazard 4D Executor, but that movie in particular had the Resident Evil theme while being scary with highly trained agents that could be killed at any turn. So I think that Chris and Leon being super agents as an excuse is just bad writing, because they're so trained they can handle anything. I think there's still people that could probably still be killed, but this is how Capcom wrote their characters. They are the living embodiment of Superman, human Superman, that they're so awesome and great they can handle everything. That's just bad writing in my opinion. There's no excuse. This is just one of those situations that involve plot armor, because Chris and Leon are the main characters. Thus, it really seems like they are immune to death. I think if the Resident Evil series really raised the stakes, made it seem like characters could die at any turn, and made the horror prevalent, then I really would believe that they actually gave this some second thought and gave this a shot. Number 3 and the final and most important con, the most important thing that needs to be fixed with the CG movies going forward, is that the current formula fiction needs to change. While I did say that it's not Resident Evil without an outbreak, the movies themselves are getting a little bit stale on the CG side. Usually the mistakes that happen is either too much uninteresting chatty segments, underutilized side characters and the same big monster set piece at the end of each movie with rarely any stakes involved, if people like Leon can survive situations like this easily. The underutilized characters can be broken down into a variety of factors. Number one could be like the villains. The villains are pretty one note. I mean, as much as people say, Wesker probably wasn't the greatest villain, at least he had a lot of hidden agendas. At least that character was somewhat interesting before they killed him off. It's funny how people associate pure evil, pure tyranny, and absolute insanity with the Albert Wesker character, and it seems like he pretty much embodied all of that and a sense of egoism as well. No character has really matched this or stayed around long enough because Capcom kept killing them off. I mean, none of the villains have been really captivating. They've been kind of one note. They put together this background sob story to make you feel sorry for the character. And while I think that the sympathetic villains are the best because you can understand their motivations better, you can understand why they went crazy, it's just not enough depth to consider it good. So we move on to the side characters, which are paper thin. If you go look at Resident Evil Vendetta, you will see this is case in point with the BSAA crew that Chris Redfield accompanies throughout half of the movie. Outside of humanizing them with one little Breaking Bad reference, these guys are pretty much lambs to the slaughter, as they usually are if they are around Chris and his endeavors. And that pretty much follows suit with this movie. I mean, they mostly get killed off, or we don't get enough time with them, or they come in at the most convenient time right at the end. But you know what the biggest slap in the face is? And this applies to a majority of Vendetta and Resident Evil Degeneration. It's what happens when big characters of the franchise are largely overlooked, like Claire Redfield and Rebecca Chambers. We have underutilized characters now, people like Rebecca and Claire Redfield not being utilized way too much in these movies and being mostly sideline characters. I really don't like that at all. It really makes me wonder, what in the hell is Capcom doing with the heroines of the Resident Evil franchise? They are strong female protagonists and they take a backseat all the time. And to see people like Claire Redfield get taken out by a piece of glass in the first movie is really, really just a dumb decision. I don't understand why. I think if they do a new entry, it's only fair, it's only justified that if they have multiple characters, it's time to give multiple characters more equal screen presence. I mean, it's all over the place now. They really need to home in the point that, yes, we do have these main characters that have been through a lot of situations, but we also have other characters in the series that people care about, and they don't want to see them shovel into a damsel in distress role. I think that is one of my biggest complaints of the Resident Evil CG movies, is that while we do see a lot of lore introduced, we do see a lot of characters. Sometimes they get undermined in terms of having a lead role. Sometimes they get overshadowed by the real leads like Leon S. Kennedy or Chris Redfield. I think there's other problems that need to be addressed, but for the most part, maybe the next Resident Evil CG movie needs to be a character piece with the outbreaks as the real enemy and the effects of the outbreaks on people's lives. Now, while Capcom does a job in showing what happens when the virus spreads out, what happens to people's families, I think they need to do a better job at bringing all this emotion at the forefront. Sometimes it's few and far between. Sometimes these character moments flip on a dime. We saw this in Vendetta with Leon's character having a role reversal, which was Chris's character in Resident Evil 6, where he was a depressed drunk all because his men got slaughtered. And now Chris seems to be the normal one in Vendetta. So it's stuff like that that feels very shoehorned in when it comes to the things affecting a character. I think there should be more character-defining moments when we talk about the Resident Evil CG films. Things that we just don't believe, things that are spectacular, things that really equate to the moment of change. I think when it comes to just zombie storytelling in general, I still love Telltale's The Walking Dead because you have time spent with the humans, you have enough time spent with the characters, and you realize the humans are just as bad as the walkers to some degree. Not saying that there aren't antagonists that really fuck shit up in terms of the Resident Evil lore. However, I think it should be a more consistent basis with the movie. Show how deplorable or show how downright self-righteous these characters are. Show how their ideals collide between protagonist and antagonist, and you might just have an interesting character piece. You might show some new ambitions from older characters. Anything can happen, and I think they should embark on this journey of showing us these new sides to the characters, these new faces that we haven't seen before yet. I think vigor, determination, and some believability would help me resonate more with the characters and would make them less paper thin in the Resident Evil CG movies, and I believe they really need this. They need a character piece, horror-driven Resident Evil with most of the pros as a backdrop, and that will honestly be the perfect Resident Evil CGI movie for me. If something needs to change, you need to focus on what works and what doesn't for the next iteration. If it ain't broke, don't fix it can apply, but sometimes you can't forget that you can always reinvent the wheel.